Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
I'm going to call the meeting to order, and I'm going to ask Mr. Blatchley if he can pray.
Sure, let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you at this time to praise you and give you thanks for all that you have done in our lives. We just ask you to give us strength tonight and do the people's business and be fair to everyone. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, we don't have any public comments tonight, so we are number four. I'll ask Mr. Honeycutt if he will introduce the Amelie.
Craig. Okay, thank you, Madam Chairwoman. Tonight we have Amelie Bush here with us tonight. Amelie is a junior at Elon, majoring in business and economics. She has served as our finance intern since the beginning of February. She has done an absolute wonderful job for us, and we appreciate the work that she's done. But kind of the project we have given her is to look at performance-based budgeting. And this is a subject that we've talked about, performance-based measures. You know, there's a lot of work that has to be done. There's a lot of education that has to be done by the board, but also by our department heads. And Amelie is here tonight to do a presentation to kind of give us an update of options and opportunities that we may have. Just to let you know, also, we have a department head meeting on Thursday, and she'll be making this presentation to the department heads as well. So with that said, I'll turn it over.
And here's a copy of the presentation.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. We're not going to pronounce your name. I would have butchered it, probably. Damn.
So the three different types of budgeting that we'll kind of be looking at are the traditional budget system, which we have in place here in Alamance, performance measures, and then performance-based budgeting, which was kind of the highest standard that we might be considering. So we'll start with performance measures. What it comes down to is that this is the collection, analysis, and reporting of data. It tracks the resources used, the work produced, and the outcomes achieved. There's generic guidelines for all departments, and then there are specific performance measures for each department that is involved with performance measures. These are based on inputs, outputs, and outcomes. So this is a great way for departments to state what their goals are, what they'd like to achieve in the fiscal year, and to track through qualitative and quantitative data how they're achieving this. Now, performance measures are based on these factors. Evaluation is organizational performance data and benchmarking. Control is to ensure that subordinates are doing the right thing. There's greater transparency. The departments working with the assistant county manager, the county manager, are able to show exactly what they're doing. This is also great for the county, for the citizens to see at the end of the fiscal year, what are they doing? How are they spending the money? You've got for the budget, there's tools in improving the performance. It motivates the department and the members of each department. They know what they're trying to achieve. They have concrete goals in front of them. They're promoting to convince the public and the administration of how the department performs. And they're also learning and improving. They're able to assess what they're doing well and what they aren't and how to improve this for the next fiscal year. Now, what they measure is how they can improve, what programs, methods, or employees are efficient. This goes back to the qualitative and quantitative data. You can see what is the cause of the department reaching a goal. What is the cause of an inefficiency in the department? And then where to better allocate the money and how departments compare. This is crucial for the budgeting process, for the assistant county manager to be able to report to the commissioners and to the citizens what's going on. Now, some of the pros are that department heads really are running their department. They have more autonomy between moving money between line items and just making sure that they can achieve these goals. They can create their own goals. They're able to say, here's what we'd like to achieve in the fiscal year. These goals change from year to year. They can be adjusted throughout the year, but this is something where working with the assistant county manager would be where that communication is. Now, the goals should be qualitative, not quantitative. working in percentages or numbers is the easiest way to say you've achieved 100% of your goal or 80% of your goal. They can better monitor and improve department performance. The transparency is greater when you know what they're trying to achieve and what the budget is really going towards. And you can see what departments are effective in regards to cost, where which line item should receive more money, which should receive less in the following year. It also displays the most critical factors, exactly what the department is doing and where their focus should be. It shows how well they're performing and their concrete accomplishments at the end of the year. And performance-based budgeting, which we'll go into later, will show what would happen with these concrete accomplishments. There's better accountability, and it achieves the ultimate purpose, which is better transparency, letting the citizens of this county know what exactly is going on. Now, some of the cons would be that not all department heads are capable of creating and necessarily following through with some of the goals that they create. This is where training would come in to let them know really what a goal should consist of. It's also difficult to sometimes compare departments. If one department works internally and another works externally, this is where goals are very different in that sense. But that's something where it depends on each county and it depends on the departments that you're comparing, where you can create benchmarks. It's also occasionally hard to set quantitative goals, to really say, you know, we're going to increase the number of emails that we respond to daily by 10%. That can't work for all departments. But again, that's something that when the department heads are working with the assistant county manager, these goals would be hashed out. It would be additional work. It wouldn't require a full-time position, but it would require someone to dedicate maybe a monthly meeting, a quarterly meeting, or working on an annual basis to make sure that departments are following through with their goals. And it also, departments may rely on summary data or historical patterns. This is something where more down the road, once you've had a number of years of performance measures, departments may look back and say, you know, relying on the historical data, or in that case, summary data too. This is something where just keeping open communication between department heads and the assistant county manager and county manager is important. Now, these are counties in North Carolina and Virginia that use performance measures. Gaston, for example, actually uses a case-by-case performance budgeting system. Mecklenburg is also close to performance-based budgeting, and New Hanover, Pitt, and actually Clatsop, Oregon are moving towards performance-based budgeting. So there are a lot of counties in North Carolina, as you can see, that have performance measures in place. This is where it would be easy to talk to these counties and to then tweak the process to fit Alamance. And this would be the management setup for performance measures. You have the department members reporting to department head, or department heads, depending on the size of the department, who would report to the assistant county manager. Usually it would be a quarterly report and then an annual meeting. The assistant county manager would report to the county manager, who would report to the commissioners. It's a nice scale to see that the commissioners really see, you know, the overall picture of what's going on, and that the work between department heads and the assistant county manager is where everything is really hashed out throughout the year. With reporting, the annual report is, what it is currently is mainly just data. The next step would be the analysis of the progress towards the outcomes for each department. You've got the explanations of their performance, it highlights areas for improvement, and it's a great way to show what operational changes need to be made. It helps in assembling the annual report, and also how well departments are understanding and utilizing performance measures. Now we'll talk about performance-based budgeting. And the main difference between the traditional budgeting that we have right now and performance-based budgeting is that traditional budgeting focuses on inputs. What are you putting in? How much money? Whereas performance-based budgeting focuses on the outputs. Now, the outputs specifically would be the achievements versus just the resources or staff that you put in. Performance-based budgeting outlines the chain of cause and effect. You really see what you're putting in and what you're getting out. It can't be implemented without a system of performance measures, though. So there really is an immediate line between traditional budgeting, performance measures, and performance-based budgeting. The difference between performance measures and performance-based budgeting is that you're linking it to the budget. You're saying, if you've met your performance measures, a certain percentage of the savings from that will go either back into the department's budget for the next year or towards the fund balance.
Can I ask you a question?
Mm-hmm.
what did you research, what the possibility of rewarding that department head for?
Specifically the department head or the department as a whole?
Department as a whole.
Well, the and what we'll kind of get into later is showing kind of the percentage of goals achieved is directly linked with the percentage of savings that a department
okay.
will keep.
You're gonna touch on that later. Okay.
So why is performance-based budgeting important? There are a lot of counties and organizations that are moving toward it. There is a direct link between, if you're setting up goals, to have it be linked back to the department's budget. It saves money for the department. They're much more careful with how they're using their budget, and also goes towards the fund balance. It's a win-win for both parts. Local government revenues are also becoming insufficient. This is where it's important to really use your resources efficiently. And it promotes the logical tie between planning and budgeting. If you've got performance measures in place, which is the planning aspect, that step towards moving it towards linking to the budget is very similar to the time and energy that you would put in to implementing performance measures. And also quantifies to citizens what the government is doing. The transparency with the performance-based budget is the budget aspect of linking it is better for the departments, but citizens really see what's going on and see, well, you know, they're getting a little bit more towards their budget because last year they cut down the cost of one line item by 50%. Now, here's how it's set up. When department heads get trained, this is kind of the process that they would follow to implement performance-based budgeting. You start with a mission, and from there you create goals and objectives. And the performance measures that each department would look at are the inputs and the outputs, how efficient they are with each input in regards to the output, and then also the quality and the outcome. So this is really where you see that performance measures are a huge part of performance-based budgeting. You've got a simple way of the general guidelines that each department will follow. And from there, each department will create their own mission, their own goals, with the overall outcome being greater transparency for the county. Now, linking savings to the budget is where there's different ways of doing it. The first is influential, which is where decision makers determine how much of the budget this department would keep. Whereas determinative is if they reach a certain percentage of their goals, they receive a certain percentage of their savings. Now, then you have incremental, where you may have marginal increases in the budget, whereas comprehensive is that you get the entire budget. So there's different ways that counties are doing it to see, you know, how much money are these counties going to get, what percentage should come back to the fund balance, and that's really something that Alamance would need to decide if to implement performance-based budgeting. And then again, you've got the standardized process for all departments and customized goals for each department. Now here you see the eligibility of savings, which is the percentage of goals achieved to the percentage of savings that each department would keep. Now this is something where each county has a different percentage of savings. There's certain rules like a department can't get back in savings more than 4% of their original budget, or more than 8%. And also, you know, if you achieve less than 60% of your goals, you don't get any savings back. And any savings that would have come from at least achieving a certain percentage go to the fund balance. And so to at least have 20% of the savings go to the fund balance gives a little bit more, more savings can go towards smaller departments or departments that aren't involved in performance-based budgeting due to restrictions or just because they haven't been involved yet. Now, here's two different ways that we can look at if a department can cut one line item's cost by 50%. If they usually receive $10,000 and they cut it down to $5,000, there's two ways of having the assistant county manager analyze what do we do for the next fiscal year. So one approach, which is done by Catawba County, is that the budget is neither increased nor decreased and that they don't analyze on a line item basis. This is where department heads are really expected to move that extra money to another line item, going back to the level of autonomy. And then in Rockingham and Davidson counties, they would look at the line items on an individual basis. They may decrease the budget. But in the end, it's not to, performance-based budgeting is not at all to punish the departments. It's not to say, you've saved money, so now we're going to take it away next year. It's so that they have the extra savings for a machine or a piece of equipment that they would like to get but have never had the money for. And so this is where they may say, well, was this $5,000 in this last year, was that normal? Was that something that's going to continue? And so that's where really taking the budget into play and seeing, was this something that, you know, you can keep up, or should we move it down to $7,500? And that's really where you're analyzing it on a line item basis and seeing how do we go forward in the next year. Now, here's some of the pros for performance-based budgeting. You've overall got greater accountability, you've controlled the costs, and it's much more flexible. Department heads are able to move budgeting from one line item to another. You've got better communication between department heads, assistant county manager, and the commissioners. You've also got greater transparency and overall higher customer service and standards. The citizens in the county really see, you know, if they're creating these goals and if departments are able to meet them, they really see a difference. And it's also on a volunteer basis. If a department isn't built to have performance-based budgeting, they're not forced to have it. This is really for departments where the department head wants to try this. This is something where they think their department can succeed, because it's not meant to at all punish and say, you haven't reached your goals, you know, we're going to decrease your budget. So it's on a volunteer basis and usually starts with between 6 and 10 departments, depending on the size of the county and the workload that the assistant county manager could take on. It also better signals the effectiveness of a program. You see, you know, what programs or what employees even are really doing their job to move towards the goals that the department has created. It's easy to research and tweak based on other counties in North Carolina. There are three specifically that have performance-based budgeting in the area that are more than willing to give information and resources to help implement it. You've got extra savings for both the departments and the fund balance. It's easy to incorporate into the budget. The, you know, annual reporting and quarterly meetings with the assistant county manager would be where the additional work would go into. And quarterly reporting really gives greater insight. The assistant county manager knows quarterly how departments are doing. It doesn't take a full year to realize you didn't meet this goal and you really, you know, you weren't on the right track for it. So having that quarterly reporting gives greater insight and in the end shows the flaws before it's too late. And it's not expensive to start up and maintain. The returns are greater than the costs. If anything, it would be the initial training to get the pilot department heads trained. But this is where a yearly training to come in and teach new department heads or to update the current ones would be the only cost. But the amount of savings that come in, both to department budgets and the fund balance, greatly outweigh the costs. Now, also, departments have greater autonomy. They're personally invested because they know what the goals are, so they know that they can achieve them. They know how to work towards them. Departments are generally very pleased. The ones that are involved in it, there are few counties that have had departments drop out. If anything, they just keep adding more every year. And it's to not only collect the data, but also to analyze it. And they don't spend all of their budget. Traditionally, if they don't spend all of their budget, you know, you may say, well, you might not need as much next year. Whereas here, you'll have more of a steady budget, and you'll be able to see the savings amount for the department. Now, some of the cons would be that, or this is what some of the counties have said as to why they haven't moved to performance-based budgeting, is that there's not enough staff. If if a county figures that they'd have to hire someone new to hold this position, then that might be something that they're not willing to invest in. But again, it's not a full-time position. This is something that the assistant county manager, it wouldn't take all of their time. It's mainly the quarterly meetings, the annual report that would consume the additional time. Political will and the administration having other priorities, this is really where you need the commissioner's buy-in. You really need the buy-in of the county manager, the assistant county manager, and the pilot department heads to really say, we're going to pull this through. You know, it's not a two-year process. There's a timeline at the end where you'll see kind of how long it would take to implement it. And this is really something that's beneficial in the long run. Some counties just preferred the traditional system of budgeting, or if they simply had performance measures, they didn't want to link it to the budget. Some also said that it was just too costly in the beginning phase, or that due to declining revenues that this was something that they were not considering this year. Some counties also said that every county is different. We know this. This is why researching it and being able to tweak it is something where, you create a process that works for your county. You create it individually for each department, and the ones that do have it have had no complaints about basing it off of other counties' progress. Intuitively, it's a sound concept, but it's challenging to put into practice. This is where having someone professional come in to do this training, that's really what you need to set up the department heads. From then on, department heads can help each other to work with goals and really striving to link it to the budget. The impact of an outcome is hard to isolate. This is where you really need to have the qualitative goals so that you can say, here is the outcome, here's the data to prove it, here's the numbers to back it up. And it's hard to focus on outcomes rather than inputs. This is a transition for department heads. If right now they're focusing on the resources, the staff, the money that they're putting in, this is something that, again, with training, you'll know what the outcome is at the end of the fiscal year. And they may be manipulative or selective with data. The counties that I've talked to have never had an issue with department heads manipulating data. But when they are analyzing it, this is where the quarterly meetings, you have that checks and balances between the assistant county manager and the department heads to make sure that that doesn't happen. Now, these are the three counties that use performance-based budgeting. The first is Catawba, who implemented it in 1994. So they've really had it around for a long time. All three counties started with between 5 and 7 pilot departments and have been adding new departments to the performance-based budgeting every year. All three of them relied on the UNC School of Government to come in and do the initial training. So that's where they had someone or a team of people come in and say, here's what a mission is, here's how to set up your goals, and here's how to really make sure that you can reach them, and just defining what everything is in the process. None of these three counties have had savings go towards a county fund or a fund balance, and this is something that all three have said they'd like to move to. So this is where Alamance would have a step up, is that if we were to implement performance-based budgeting, we'd start with a percentage of savings going to each department, but then a percentage of that also going to the fund balance immediately. And that's something where they said, smaller departments aren't reaping any benefits, but they're too small to get involved with performance-based budgeting. And so that's something that all three have said they were looking into. Now, all of them have also said that while there are higher costs in the short run, especially for the initial training, that the returns greatly outweigh the costs. Now, the management for performance-based budgeting is pretty much the same for performance measures. The department heads look over their department. They submit monthly or quarterly reports. They meet with the assistant county manager, and the assistant county manager reports to the county manager, who reports to the commissioners. And again, it's not a full-time position, and the department heads really take care of the data and the analysis, the nitty-gritty stuff. And now for benchmarking, there are a number of ways to see how departments are doing, and then also there's benchmarking between counties. Internally is to compare one department's year to a previous year. Externally would be comparing department to department. Operational is the recent annual or periodic performance, and then strategic is looking in the long run. And now there's three comparisons of systems that we have, and these are from Davidson County. They've had performance-based budgeting for a while, and they really break down nicely, for the citizens to see, here's what we're doing. And so EMS is an external department, and you can see the performance measures that they have set up, and then the goals that they set for the fiscal year, and the result. And so now all of this is qualitative data. You can really see the percentage going down with each result. And so Davidson County would have, for this department, they'd be eligible for the highest percentage of savings because they almost reached 100%, between 90% and 100% of their goals. Now, finance is an internal department, and this is where you see goals more along the lines of dates and the number of days. This is where you can't have the same types of goals as that EMS would. And so to have it sent by a certain date or to post budget amendments within a certain number of days, again, that's where you can create these percentages and see just how well they're doing. And then human resources is also an internal department, reducing the employee accident rate, containing the health or the employee health benefit cost increase. They said that they'd like to contain it by 10% or, you know, no more than 10%. They were able to keep it down to 8%. And these are the type of goals that the departments are working with that are important to them and then also help the citizens. Now, performance measures, or moving from performance measures to performance-based budgeting, are really just a stepping stone. There is very little extra time or energy that you have to put in for moving between this. You've got the goals set up. You know what each department is doing. You've got the quarterly meetings, the annual report. It's just a matter of linking it to the budget, determining how much or what percentage of the savings and, you know, what percentage would go to the fund balance. The benefit is definitely in the long run. Again, the short run costs are definitely within one or two fiscal years. You really see that overlapping right away. And it's easy to model after other counties, but you really need the full buy-in of the departments that are going to be working with it, and especially the commissioners. This is something where, you know, knowing is this good for our county and kind of seeing how other counties have done it, it's important to have the full buy-in in order for this to really work. And here's the timeline that we kind of talked about how we'd be able to implement this. And if on June 1st they started training the departments that were going to be the pilot programs to use performance measures, it would give them about 6 months to try to implement performance measures. So you'd start with just creating the goals and creating what they want to achieve without necessarily saying, here's the percentage that you're going to get at the end if you have any savings. And so from January 1st, 2011 to June 30th, 2012, so 18 months, you would monitor how they do with these performance measures. Are they able to meet these goals? Are they understanding what a goal should be? Are they creating goals that are hard enough that they can achieve them, but that they're not just creating goals just to receive the savings at the end? And then on July 1st, 2012, at the start of the fiscal year, you would assess these departments' accomplishments, and for the ones that really seem to get a grip of what performance measures are, you would start performance-based budgeting. And so for the 2012 to 2013 fiscal year, you would assume that they will have their performance measures linked to the budget. And then in 2013, you'd see the first savings go back to the departments. So it's, you know, it can be a 2-3 year process to really implement it. It depends on whether or not you want to start with performance measures and then move into performance-based budgeting, or just go ahead and start them all at once. And so that's a decision to kind of make with the department heads that are in, you know, excited to get this moving, and the commissioners and the county manager. And then these are the three main resources that we found for implementing performance-based budgeting. The School of Government at UNC Chapel Hill has been named by every county. I mean, they are the go-to people for really implementing this. And then Cascade performance-based budgeting software is a software designed to help implement and improve performance-based budgeting. This will range, if you're assuming about 50 users, which, depending on the number of departments that you start with, can range from about $12,500 to $17,500. And so that would be to have those users online, help them access it, and it's very interactive software to see, you know, how you can improve these goals, how to create them, and what works best for each department. And that price range is because of the General Service Administration, depending on whether or not a local government would fall into that category. And that's something that if Alamance were to work with Cascade, that's something that we would find out as the process moves along. And then ICMA is the Center for Performance Measurement. A number of counties are involved, and this is where they receive trainings, newsletters, data reports, and access to forums. And so that's a great way to kind of benchmark across the U.S., not just in North Carolina, to see how you can improve. And that is that. Are there any questions?
Well, I'd like to touch on one that Bill alluded to. You know, I've never worked for government until I got this position as a commissioner. Mm-hmm. I always worked for private business. And whether it was banking, whether it was a loan finance company, you know, I spent about 30 years roughly in that business. And
you don't look that old, does it?
Yeah. Thank you. Everybody at the management level has some skin in the game. And if for instance, if a branch manager of a branch, for instance, I worked for a company that was nationwide, and we had, our region was two states, North and South Carolina. The main office was in Charlotte. If the branch manager wanted a bonus, he would have to hustle and get his loan managers to perform, pass goals. He would have to get his finance manager to perform, pass goals. He would have to have his CSRs, his customer service reps, to perform, pass goals, and clerks, everybody. And then he could get a $5,000 bonus possibly at the end of the year on top of his salaries. Did you see any philosophy in there at all that department heads could get a cash bonus versus, see, what I see that you run into when you take your savings and put it back into the department, you're going to run, and I'm not saying I'm against it, I'm just saying that you do see some of a problem here, that you're going to see Pandora's box opened as far as, well, what would have been included in the regular budget request versus what we're going to be able to use the savings, you know, the reward back into the department for. In other words, I mean, did you see a philosophy at all for cash bonuses? Because it's my belief that if a department head, whether it be Chuck, whether it be Susan, or whoever, library, if you can get more out of your workers, more out of the performance, more out of the results, more out of the efficiency, and you know you're going to get $3,000 if you can save 10 or if you can save 20 or whatever, then I think you snap the whip a little bit harder, and I don't mind using that term, to get it done versus, well, we're going to get the money, you know, we're going to get it through budget request, or we're going to get it through meeting our goals, the money's going to come back in the department. I think you might be a little softer on implementation, but you know, my point is, of asking the question, did you see anybody that was willing to give cash bonuses for success?
Well, specifically how each county and then each department handles bonuses was something that I didn't quite go into detail, but what I do know is that while departments have greater autonomy to move budget or savings between line items, there are certain restrictions as to how freely they can move this, just as there are with the traditional budgeting system. And so this is something where a bonus or a raise or adding personnel is something that would go from the department head to the assistant county manager and might come up to the commissioners, depending on what kind of a request it is. But so moving it between line items, depending on a certain amount of money, is something that department heads have the autonomy to do. But when it comes to bonuses, that's something that, you know, they can't just say, okay, I'm going to give myself $3,000 extra because, you know, overall. But so that's something where the assistant county manager would see, was there one goal that was achieved and that was a lot of savings, or did we across the board achieve the goals? And that's where you can say, well, you know, if the department had, if this goes back to them, then you really see the efficiency across the department versus just, you know, one program really worked out, and that's where we saw $10,000 worth of savings.
When Tim and I went down to Davidson County, that county is the one that precipitated us looking at this, and it was going on 2 years ago, and if you look at 2+, you said we'd have to have it done for implementation. That's,
I'm just kidding.
Not good performance-based budget, you know, as far as timeline there. But they had in the national article that was out about their success, I think they had saved roughly $1 million, or there was $1 million efficiency involved. What are their numbers now? Or in Catawba and the other third county, we're Rockingham, I guess you said.
Well, something that's important to note with that is that the amount of savings that they have, it's divided within the departments.
I understand.
It doesn't all just go back to one department, and so the bottom line on the budget isn't affected as much as they would say they have in savings. Right. And so, you know, if they say that they've saved $500,000 or $1 million over the course of the last 4 or 5 years, that's something where it doesn't directly go to the bottom line.
I understand that, but what are the numbers they're generating now, though? Do you know?
For Davidson, I'm not entirely sure. I mean, by department.
What about, well, total?
Total, I'm not sure.
What about Catawba?
Well, for the bottom line or for how much they're
just
generating
what they
in total?
Claim that performance-based budgeting is netting out for them.
I don't know totals.
Okay. So I think Davidson, when we first went down, it was $1 million, roughly. And I didn't know if the same was progressing or not, or if it was continuous, or if it was dropping as a result of them getting as efficient as possible, or
whatever. The sense that I got from them was that year by year, departments were getting more efficient as they became more comfortable with the goals that they were creating. They were able to better plan the fiscal year once the department heads had a few years under their belt of doing this. And so I really only heard positive things about how it's affecting the bottom line, how it's affecting each department and the fund balance overall. I don't have numbers, though.
Okay. Any more questions?
Just maybe one on the cost of implementation.
Mm-hmm.
What estimates have you, did you do anything on that?
Mm-hmm. Well, for the School of Government at UNC, for the initial training, it would be about $5,000. And so that would be really training the department heads as a whole and also the assistant county manager and the county manager, depending on the involvement, but just so that there's that general overview. And so that's the kind of the first year cost. After that, costs were estimated to be about $1,000 per year, just to kind of have a retraining, something that's not as time consuming as to train 9 or 10 department heads, multiple department heads, and possibly members too, to really get the ball rolling. But again, even with the $5,000 cost, that's, you know, to see first the performance measures, but if performance-based budgeting were to be implemented after 2-3 years, that's when the savings would come in and wouldn't even compare to the $5,000 cost.
And also on the Cascade or whatever, I may have missed it. Did you have a cost on those?
Yeah, Cascade, assuming that it would be about 50 users, and this would include kind of IT, multiple department heads, and just getting everyone on board, even if it is only 6 departments that pilot this, it would be between $12,500 and $17,500.
For that software.
Mm-hmm. And so that would I'm pretty sure that would include in-person training too, but it's mainly online and it's you know, very interactive.
And would
in
it
that
be
sense.
A fee, yearly fee on that?
I believe so.
Is Davidson using Cascade?
Sure, it would be.
None of these three counties, Catawba, Davidson, or Rockingham, are using Cascade, but this is something that showed up quite a lot while I was doing research, just as to the tools that they have. They're based in D.C., and I spoke with the president of the company on a number of occasions. So it's really very hands-on, and he's the one that designed the software.
Did you go to any of these counties personally, or all of these counties?
I did not go to any of them personally. From Rockingham, Adam Lindsay, who's actually, his position was created as the director of performance measures, he spoke very highly of having other counties come in or going to them to see it.
Yeah, because that's what I'd like to do before I even.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Well, we went to Davidson, and I wouldn't mind going to Catawba. But,
but none of us have been.
Well, I understand. I didn't say that you had. You know, you can make it as bureaucratic as you want to. You know, I would assume that you could go to social services, EMS, and say, okay, hypothetically, you're the department head. You know how many employees you've got. You know how many calls you make. You know all the variables of your department. Hypothetically, if you could sit down and design, even if it's something you say now that you can't meet, but if you could design an efficiency path of success, of more efficiency in all your departments, in all your variables, let's see what they would be. Doesn't mean you can meet them, doesn't mean that it's even possible. But, you know, I think we could do it in-house if we were as sharp as I would like to see us be. But, you know, we'll broker out what we have to if we decide we want to do it. But that's the way I feel about it. I mean, it just sounds like, you know, you can make it as bureaucratic as you want.
And that's where it's important to just find the balance between how much do you take from your own county and how much do you take from others,
right.
How much information you're taking and that you're going to put into practice at Alamance.
Right.
Okay, can I add something to Ms. Bush? I'm afraid I'll mispronounce your first name.
Mm-hmm.
Is it possible that some departments may want to try this and get started or get on board, and then others may come on later? Is that a possibility? I noticed in here that full compliance, a full buy-in was really needed to show the big savings.
Well, the full buy-in kind of comes from the upper management level with...
Oh, okay.
What I meant by full buy-in is really that you have the support of the commissioners, first off. You really need it coming down from the top. But the full buy-in is the full buy-in of the department heads that are going to be pilot programs. No county starts with all departments or half or even close. They really start with a number in the single digits. It's easier to manage. It's much easier to implement. And it's really not putting that much of a burden on the assistant county manager, because that person, too, needs the training, needs to learn how this is going to work. And they have no idea how each department head is going to deal with implementing this. But so that's where having pilot programs, you really get the department heads and departments that are able to do this and really want to do this. And just having that motivation helps to implement it tremendously.
Okay, that's, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any more questions?
No, but you did a wonderful job of making that presentation.
That was a good
thank
job.
You. Well, thank you.
Thank you. And how long have you been in on
this? It's my third year.
You and I can just go somewhere then.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Emily. Okay, next we have a presentation from David Leonard for the Fallen Heroes Memorial Committee presentation.
Madam Chair and County Commissioners, I come before you tonight to share with you a project that is currently underway that will be a memorial to all fallen emergency services workers within Alamance County. There have been talks of this project for several years now, and a few months ago, a few members within the emergency services throughout this county got together and decided to bring this thing to light here for us tonight. And so tonight I'm proud to let you know that the Alamance County Fallen Heroes Memorial is well underway. This memorial incorporates all of the emergency service agencies that protect our county. All law enforcement, rescue personnel, EMS personnel, 911 telecommunicators, and fire department personnel that have given their life for the protection of the citizens within our county will be forever remembered and honored with this memorial. We also intend to include any former citizen or current citizen of Alamance County that has given their life while working with the emergency services with agencies other than here in Alamance County. The criteria for eligibility for this memorial is what is considered by the state as a line of duty death, or the ultimate sacrifice. The City of Graham has offered us a prime piece of property located on the grounds that will house the new Children's Memorial Museum, the new Children's Museum. This committee has been working closely with the City of Graham, Askew Peterson Monuments, and other business leaders and people throughout the county to plan this memorial, and is now currently starting a major fundraising campaign to raise the needed funds for this project, which is estimated to be around $200,000. And these monies will not only pay for the installation, but also the continued upkeep of this memorial for years to come. It's something that we want to put together and something that we want to be proud about and have pride in what we're putting together. These fundraising events will include things such as car shows throughout the community, tractor pulls, community dinners, motorcycle shows, sponsored motorcycle rides, and raffles throughout the community at various times. Although we have not put a target date for completion on this project, we are off to a good start with raising monies now. We're not asking for any monetary amounts from the county, but on the behalf of all the emergency service agencies within Alamance County, we ask for your support in helping us spread the word regarding this wonderful project that we are seeking to put here for Alamance County. I've had the opportunity personally to work with the neighboring county, Guilford County, as they put together a fallen firefighters memorial several years ago. And I can tell you the experiences in putting that thing together were great and wonderful, but the reward of what we had in the finished product was extremely humbling, and it still is to this day each time we visit it. I've also had an opportunity to go to Raleigh on several occasions and visit the state memorial for the fallen firefighters, which is one in which anyone that has died in line of duty with the state firefighters, his name is inscribed there for that memorial. And that, too, is truly a humbling experience to take place in that. Well, what we hope to give to the citizens here of Alamance County is a more localized place for them to go and take a memorial and remember those who have paid the ultimate sacrifice of here in Alamance County. It's our intent to come before you several more times throughout this process as we get closer to completion on it to keep you updated with what's taking place. We've had several people working on a pretty good drawing of this, and I hope to bring that presentation to you in the next few months too as well. I think you'll be pleasantly surprised and pleased with what we have put together for this memorial. We're very proud of it. So again, it's our intent to keep you updated. And at this time, I'll answer any questions that you may have. I'd be glad to.
I guess, what can we do other than just telling everybody?
Help us get the word out there and spread it. If you see any sponsored events coming up, we would like your support in being there with us and rally behind us with that. Any ideas you have for fundraisers, we welcome it. When we have meetings and things, we'll offer that for your opportunity to come and join us with that too as well. Something that I think the county is going to be very proud to have in place.
It's going to be a great location.
Yeah. Yes, sir. It's going to be an outstanding. The city of Graham really stepped up to the plate and offered us a great piece of property there that will be visible for everyone coming into the main area there for the main parking. Their maintenance folk are going to actually keep, you know, the upkeep on it. We're going to have it landscaped very neatly, so they're going to take care of that too as well. So we're very proud of it and thankful for Graham the opportunity to have that located really here in the heart of Alamance County, right in the center of the county. So what better place for it?
That's great.
Do you have any idea when this will start?
Well, we've got our goal technically is to have about 120,000 in place before we actually start the construction of it. That will pay for the actual monuments, lay the groundwork for the foundations, footings, and things that have to be a retaining wall will be put in place too as well. And that was our target dollar amount that we wanted. The additional monies there will be for the continued upkeep from here, you know, as long as we can. That's what we're looking at.
Okay. Well, you are on the next item as well.
Yes, ma'am. I'm on the next
item. Sole source purchase. Just keep on going, David.
Yes, ma'am. This is in regards to the Alamance County Emergency Operations Center 800 megahertz project. As you're aware, the Alamance County Emergency Management Office and Fire Marshal's Office will be moving into its new facility located beneath the Family Justice Center on Martin Street in Burlington. As I have previously reported, a community policing grant, or COPS grant, was secured, and a portion of these funds has been allocated to provide equipment for the 800 megahertz project within this new facility, as well as provide necessary equipment for our emergency service personnel throughout Alamance County. The following is a list of required items that will be purchased with the COPS grant funding to accommodate the communications equipment and installation. And it's quite a lengthy list there of 9 items. But the total is $63,090.93. With the 800 megahertz project, when it began in Alamance County, Motorola Commonwealth was awarded the contract to supply the equipment for, including the radios and the infrastructure for our countywide system. Commonwealth Radio has been working on the installation of all this new equipment within our new EOC, and the above-listed equipment interacts with all that they are currently installing. I come before you tonight to request that you allow me to sole source the purchase and installation of these items listed above to Commonwealth Radio of Motorola. As we move forward with the above equipment purchases, all from the COPS grant funds, I would request that we continue to use Commonwealth as our provider for this additional equipment. And I'd like to also add that the facility is moving along very nicely. I was in there this afternoon after being gone for a week. And, you know, with each time, each visit in, you see quite a bit of progress. A lot of this equipment is actually going to be utilized for our secondary or our backup communications to our 911 center below. So it is much needed equipment.
Do you need a budget amendment on this as well?
It's part of the grant.
So I don't think so. I just need to be allowed to sole source this out in the Commonwealth.
Okay.
All right.
We need a motion for that.
We need a motion, I guess. I'll make the motion. I'll second it.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Discussion?
Aye. No opposed? Okay.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Okay, the next thing on our agenda is Ms. Goodrum. Did I say that right? That's good. Okay. Library policy update, and I think y'all all have a copy of that.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. I'm here before you to ask for your approval to the proposed revisions of two library policies. The first one is the behavior policy. And the Alamance County Public Libraries Board met recently to review the behavior policy of the Alamance County Libraries. And you should have in front of you the proposed revision in which the sentence, please report any and all infractions of this policy to library staff, has been added to the last policy. And I believe that has to be approved by you all before we can implement that.
Okay. You want us to do that or wait?
You want to wait, whatever.
That'd be fine. That'd be fine.
The next policy is the computer access policy. And the current library computer access policy was adopted in December of 2002 and was last revised on April 7th, 2008. In response to a request from County Attorney Clyde Albright and County Manager Craig Honeycutt, the Alamance County Public Libraries Library Board met recently to review this policy. It was felt that there was a need to address access of patron records by law officials. Staff and Library Board recommend the approval of a new paragraph listed as number 10 in the policy, which is the actual wording of the North Carolina General Statute Section 125-19, and this will serve as a reminder to our patrons of situations and conditions in which their records can be accessed. The copy of the policy that you have includes that 10th paragraph with a revision.
Any questions?
I'm glad that you're doing that. Something needed to be done.
With the advent of computers, it's made things a little more complicated.
Yeah.
And all we're doing is simply adding in that North Carolina general statute that says this is when your records can be accessed under these conditions, with a subpoena, with your written consent, and for the operations of the library.
Well, do we need to do two separate motions? I mean, we've got two policies we're accepting here.
Yeah, probably is the best way.
Okay.
I'll make a motion that we do the accept the behavior policy.
Okay. I'll second.
That's the first. I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? And on the next one is the library computer access policy. I hear a motion.
I'll make that motion.
I have a motion there. Second.
All in favor? Before you go, is there anything going on about the people outside on the sidewalk that harass people?
There is no city ordinance for smoking or loitering right outside the door. Our behavior policy actually states that there is to be no smoking within 10 feet of the library entrance. However, that's not necessarily an enforceable law. I mean, we can go and ask them to move and state that it's in the policy, but there's no law. We can't call the police if they refuse, because there's no law that says they can't be there. I met with Harold Owen and Jeff Woods of the police department, and they suggested putting up no smoking signs, but then said we can't call the police to enforce it if we're challenged on it.
I mean, I've gone in the library many times at May Memorial, four or five people standing out there cursing like a sailor, begging for money. It's really unbelievable.
It is an issue because we are in a downtown area, and most public libraries that are in downtown areas have the issue with the homeless and the places to hang out.
Now, I like the duffel bag deal. What, of course, you're going to get into a debate about what's a large duffel bag, what's not. that's the way they handled it down at Myrtle Beach at Chapin Memorial. They had people coming in off the beach, going upstairs, literally laying on the table, sleeping. They created a policy years ago that you couldn't bring in a duffel bag, period. And the logic was they weren't going to leave their personal belongings outside, so they, as a result, they didn't come in. So where do they put their duffel bags?
I have not seen duffel bags in the library since I've been there, and I've only been there a little over a month. So
a visitor to our community will have a duffel bag when he comes in.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes, ma'am.
As far as teenagers using the facilities there, how do we observe or keep them from using the computers in a way that we wouldn't feel would be healthy for them? That's a nice way of putting it all.
We have filters in place, but because we are not at this point, we don't have a policy that says they cannot use computers for like social websites like Facebook or MySpace or things like that. And of course, anything illegal, we would immediately shut down their session if they were pulling up illegal pornography or things like this. I do encourage, and we have been addressing this, but we do encourage staff to sort of what I call go walkabout and just, you know, browse through and see and if anything illegal is going on. And we do have security guards there in the evenings to also not sit behind the desk, but to walk around the area and the perimeter.
It's not just for teenagers, but
for everybody.
For those that may be looking to meet a teenager.
Sexual predators, and that's where all this came, sort of came about.
So y'all watching out for that?
Yes,
too.
Ma'am.
So they can go on Facebook.
They can go. It gets into a whole gray area. Some sexual predators are banned from computer use. And if we try to work closely with the police departments to have those identified so that we know. And when they come in and get on the computer, then we can knock them off or call the police to come help us get them off. When they're there, if they are allowed to go on the computer, we don't have the right to say, other than if it's an illegal pornography site or something that is actually illegal, it's not really our purview to say, yes, you can go on Facebook, but you can't. The list that we would have in order to do that, it would be an increase in staff and resources.
Several years ago, this is a true story. Several years ago, it was, as a matter of fact, the asteroid was pictured in the paper here just this other day when Obama says, you know, he wants to land on an asteroid or go to Mars. And this particular asteroid was in the paper just the other day. I won't mention the name of it, but when I punched in the name of that asteroid, because it does have a name that can be taken on the other side. And I'm sitting at the library, and I typed in. Well, there was a program called NEAR, the acronym for Near Earth Asteroid Rendezvous, and it was about this. We landed a satellite on this particular asteroid, and it zoomed in and landed and actually landed. And so I was following it for almost 8 months. And I'm up at the library, and I typed in the name of this asteroid, and you wouldn't believe what came up on the screen. And I'm trying to punch it off, and the more you punch it off, the more other stuff came up.
You call the cops.
Now we know who to look out for.
Now we know why you put that policy in place.
I didn't unplug it, but I started to.
Well, and we have filters that handle some of that. But, I mean, suppose you've got a student that's doing a paper on breast cancer, sure. And, of course, you can imagine then some of that's going to get filtered out and he won't have access to the information. So it's a fine line to walk between providing the information and, you know, preventing bad things from happening to people.
Can I make a recommendation?
Yes, ma'am.
when he comes back in to use a computer, just be sure he uses one that has all the filters on it.
And I'll have my security guard keep an extra eye out for him.
Well, they need to rename the asteroid something. Pull up sites, so what can I say?
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, next on our agenda is a budget amendment from the Health Department.
Mine is not exciting whatsoever.
That's all I think.
Madam Chairman, Commissioners, thank you all. We have a recommendation to you all for a budget amendment that is a sum of $861. These are funds that we receive from the North Carolina Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention Program, and we'll use this towards the salary of our health educator one, who works with the schools trying to do things like reduce teenage pregnancy, reduce substance abuse, inform kids about healthy living, other adolescent concerns about lifestyles, behaviors, and healthy choices. So we're just asking for your approval to put this money towards her salary.
Any questions?
Nope.
Do I hear a motion we accept this budget amendment?
So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Best. Okay, now we go to county manager.
I do want to let you know, good evening, that
I
made this presentation today at 11 o'clock to the department heads to make them aware of what was going to be presented tonight. And I started off with a joke that they didn't get, and it kind of went downhill from there. So
The budget wasn't funny.
But here's the joke. Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Spell.
Spell who?
WHO. And it was downhill from there.
We understand.
I still have fear.
What do you mean by that?
I did too.
He said, who's there?
He got it.
Look.
We got it.
Again, to go quickly over what we presented at our budget retreat. As we talked about earlier, we are $10.2 million at a revenue shortfall at this point. Right now, that included no revenue adjustments of a tax increase, sales tax increase, or any fund balance usage. So without any revenue adjustments, any further cuts from what you saw, we're $10.2 million in the hole. Again, since the last couple of weeks, we've worked very closely with our finance department to try to come up and meet these budgetary shortfalls. And again, just some quick budget facts. It was presented at the workshop. Property tax is 51% of our budget, sales tax 15%, other taxes and miscellaneous 2%, fees and permitting 13%, federal and state funding 19%. And the number of our current budgeted full-time equivalent employees are 1,041. Again, to go over the issues that we have in this year's budget, or this coming year's budget, that's different from this year. The new additional debt service, and this is part of our facilities improvement of $9.3 million, is $1.2 million additional. Again, we budgeted $250,000 in this year's budget for one quarter of debt service. But in next year, 2010-11, we will have an additional $1.2 million. As we've talked about over and over again, we didn't meet revenue neutral, and that was our goal in last year's budget. So we're short on that, $1.69 million. We have new costs for security at civil courts downstairs. Hopefully, we are in the process of getting a electronic scanner being donated to us, and thanks to the sheriff for that from the Marshal Service, but it's going to cost to have that facility manned. So we're looking at between $80,000 and $90,000 for that. Again, as we talked about at our last meeting, new probation rental charges. We've been paying $53,000 a year. Now the state has required that we do all probation. So now it's an additional $75,000. Mandatory state retirement increase for employees, $550,000. Not a choice that we have. They have not increased the employer's contribution in about 10 years. So it was kind of time with the lagging market that they felt like they had to get the accurate or the adjustments up. One of the things we have added back in that we didn't have last year was a request from ACC was an additional $40,000. They are putting a 10,000 square foot building online beginning July 1. We're responsible for the maintenance and upkeep and utilities of that building. We have been told that a good figure to use is about $4 a foot. So that's an additional $40,000 of above and beyond their current allocation. If we look at that, and again, this is just different from this year, we start off at $3.64 million in the hole. Here's some cut suggestions. And again, from our budget retreat, that was kind of the theme. Let's cut, and see where we can cut. So we looked at a lot of different options. Number one was school funding. They had a $1.5 million increase over the current year budget. We're looking at cutting that. Again, a lot of school systems are getting not even what they got this year. They're getting cuts, you know, and no increases. So we feel like remaining flat with the school system right now is a fair thing to do. We've talked about furloughs for employees. One of the things we looked at was 5 days for non-emergency employees, 3 days for emergency employees. That would be $593,000 we could end up saving. And again, these are options. 1 day of non-emergency is $98,000 per day. 1 day of emergency is $59,000. So that's kind of how that breaks out. Furloughs will be tied into holidays every other month for non-emergency employees. And I have a slide that we'll talk about how we would possibly could do furloughs. Cut capital vehicle expenses, $579,000. We had two proposed ambulances and EMS, seven cars in the sheriff's department. The jail had a new vehicle. Fire marshal had a new truck. Tax administrator had a new car. So we were cutting all vehicle expenses. Additional vehicle cut or budget cuts. We were going to go back and ask the departments for an additional 1%. This does not include, this is on operation. This is not on salary. This would be on operation. Again, we were going to look at freezing cutting any new position and reclass at this point. That would be $73,638. And again, we froze positions in last year's budget that we haven't filled. So the thought process is just cut them and get rid of them so we don't have to worry about budgeting. That's $267,000. And there's a list of the positions. Changes to revenue. We have gone back and re-looked at our revenue projections. We increase our sales tax to flat, and that's an increase of $1.6 million. In looking at our sales tax starting to get a constant and starting to hit close to budget, also with the addition of Tanger next year, we feel like staying flat, we should be in fairly good shape. So we feel like we can add $1.6 million back. The use of ADM funds from the school system to cover the debt service shortfall, that using $1.7 million of their ADM fund. This requires a joint resolution between the Board of Commissioners and the school board. But we can use this funding because Article 40 is projected revenue for school debt service. Article 42 is needed for the debt service. Right now, those two articles are not meeting the school's debt service. And we're having to use $1.7 million from our general fund to balance out the school's debt service. So that's why we would like to look at a resolution of asking for that money from the school system.
Have you talked to them concerning that?
We've talked to them about we're going to try to get money in this year's budget. We're actually meeting with them tomorrow to talk about the ADM issues and to lay out our sales tax projections with them. Don't know how that's going to go over at this point, So we're interested to see how that meeting will do. Again, we've adjusted some of our line item revenues, you know, changing 10,000 here, 20,000 there. If you look at the whole menu of revenues that we have, we felt like we could adjust that up 400,000. Use of designated fund balance. You know, as we've talked about before, we have designated fund balance and undesignated fund balance. Our big concern is the undesignated fund balance because that's kind of the money that we can spend. The designated fund balance that we're looking at of 500,000 is projects that have been on the books for years that probably need to be cleaned up and kind of be undesignated. So that's the use of that for $500,000. We are recommending at this point looking at a 1.75 tax increase. That would take us from 52 to 53 and three quarters. That would be a little over $2 million at $2,043,000. Again, as we mentioned earlier about furlough days, if that was the option that the board so chose, we would look at emergency personnel. That would be 3 days floating throughout the year. There are some things we do have to do with the furlough days. We would have to look at how we would cover those shifts as well. So there's still some costs that would be associated with those furlough days. If this is an option we want to do, then we'll have to kind of get down to brass tacks and work with Chuck and Dexter and the sheriff and try to come up with exactly what that cost and that cost savings is. 5 days for non-emergency employees. The thought process is to tie it to holidays and to do it at an every other month increment. So that way you don't get a hit 2 months in a row. Overall, the 5 days represent like 1.97% of salary, total salaries. But if we make it in a, give them a longer weekend tied to the holiday, it's kind of a benefit back. We would be closed on those days as well. Offices would be closed. Again, right now we would be closed on the holiday of July 5th. We would close July 2nd. Then September 3rd would be a furlough day. Monday, September 6th, Labor Day holiday. So that would again give us that long weekend. We would get another day at Christmas. There's not really a holiday in February, but a lot of people take off our President's Day, which is on a Monday. That would be a furlough day. And then we would tie in Easter Monday with Good Friday and give us a long weekend there.
So you saying you're going to close the county on those days as well?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. On those five furlough days, the entire county offices would be closed if approved.
Okay.
Again, this is kind of a snapshot of where we're at for expenditure changes and revenues. $3.683 million in cuts, $6.243 million in revenues that were that we could feel like we can add back. That would still leave us a little bit short. Begin budget at $10.2 million in the red. We would be $274,000 short. However, use of $274,000 short, we feel like, would not hurt our fund balance. You know, again, the cuts we've made in this current year budget, and then last year, or in this year, we projected to use $2.39 million. So to use $275,000 is really nothing, you know, and compared to what has been used with respect to fund balance in the past. With respect to employee compensation, we would recommend that we go back and look at three bonus days as we've done the last couple of years. You know, again, that's kind of vacation days that people can have off. They do not go in your vacation bank of hours. So it's not a direct liability. The only loss is work time. And again, they must be used before any other vacation is used. We would also ask that the Board of Commissioners review raises in January. That time, we should have a good handle on where our revenues were at from property tax to sales tax and see if we're on target or ahead. You know, if we're just barely meeting budget, it may not be the time to look at raises. But if we're far ahead with our projections, you know, it may be something to consider at that time. Since it'll be the last across-the-board increase for employees would be July 2008. What's next? Need a direction from the board on proposed cuts and tax rate. Kind of need to get a consensus because we're getting down to the point of where we need to present to you a manager's recommended budget. Right now, the schedule is to present you that manager's recommended budget on May 3rd with a public hearing on May 17th. However, if we're not ready, if we need additional discussion, if you need additional time, we can push that back and give you the recommended budget on the 17th with a public hearing on June 7th if necessary. So we can push back that time frame, you know, according to your wishes. And that's all I have at this moment.
I'll open the board up here for comments or questions at this time. Eddie?
Didn't we agree at the budget retreat at 10?
I hadn't had time to soak all this in.
Agree at the budget retreat that 10 million included some pass-through money that we don't match or that we're not responsible for from the county?
It is part of the federal funding as well. I think we're $2 million short on federal.
Well, the federal and state part has decreased, but a big portion of that was the 1.7 of the ADM funds in the school system.
Right.
I think as far as federal and state funding, it had decreased like 2.3, and 1.7 of that was the ADM funds.
I mean, I thought we were showing of the $10 million that we were really only short $6 million and some odd dollars. I thought that was the figure that was thrown out there at the library.
I think it was discussed, and again, part of that is, but I guess looking at overall,
unless I'm just missing the boat here, and I probably am, I'm not concerned about monies that we're not responsible to match. In other words, I mean, I want to see net county dollars that we're responsible for. Either with the raising of taxes or cuts to show me appropriations versus revenues. I mean, again, are we short $10 million in county dollars or is it $6 million, $7 million? See, that's what's confusing the H out of me. It almost looks like smoke and mirrors to me. I mean, and I hadn't seen that chart yet.
I think when we were at the retreat, we were trying to do some guessing, and I'll be very honest, we haven't got a handle on that figure at this moment.
Yeah. Well, see, again, I couldn't care less about monies that we don't that we're not responsible for filling the gap for because the state cut it out or the feds cut it out. I mean, unless it's mandated that we do. And it appears to me that of that $10 million, there's quite a few dollars in there that it's not mandated that we replace because the feds cut it out or the state cut it out. Again, I'm just shooting from the hip here. I admit that. But that's how unclear it is for me.
And
now's a bad time maybe to try to recreate the wheel on this. But, you know, it looks like to me it'd be simpler to show us. We should be able to see some things a little more simpler to understand. To me.
Is there a way to do that we could meet and have another presentation?
Well, I guess the pass-through money, probably Mr. Sutton, that you're referring to, as far as some of the departments that some of their federal and state funding has been cut, they have also cut on their expenditure side, too, to kind of compensate for that. Most of the federal or the state funding that we're short, like I said, part of it's the ADM fund, and then it's kind of a combination of other state funds, like, for example, beer and wine, which, you know, really is not tied to any department. That's just a state revenue we get. And, you know, where we may have been getting $225,000, now it may just be $175,000. So it's other miscellaneous state funds that have just not come in.
I understand that.
Franchise fees and things like that that have decreased, that really are not tied to a specific department.
And I think Amy probably hit the nail, where we have been short on some of those pass-through accounts, departments have taken that into consideration on the expenditure side. So they've taken that as the offset already to this point. The dollar figure may be closer to, you know, what it is now at 10.2.
Now, the revenue neutral, where we set 52, and then the reevaluation changes, we lost, what, $300 million?
May have been closer to $400 million evaluation, wasn't that?
What, as far as the value?
Total valuation.
Yeah, we lost.
The total value was like 433 billion or something, that it actually went down.
Oh, million.
Which equates million. Out to
430,
like, yeah. I mean, it equates out to about 2 million in revenue,
right,
loss.
Right. How much?
About 2 million. Plus another thing that's hurt is that the collection rate on the tax department, see, that decreased a little bit too. So we've lost about 400,000 there, because you have to use the most current collection rate. And, you know, by that dropping a little bit, you know, we're losing another about 400,000 there. So, you know, between the reval and then the collection rate dropping, that's where we're at.
And I do want to thank Gerald and his staff for really taking the bull by the horns and really trying to make collections a priority again. And we have seen a tick up in the percentage a little bit, but it's been a long road to hoe to get us where we need to be. But they are really taking it hard. If you've seen the charts on the garnishments and the attachments that they've done so far, you know, trying to make sure that we utilize all of our revenue streams.
We are doing foreclosures.
Yes, ma'am.
I mean, every day.
Clients staying busy with that.
So. Yeah, I think that rate will go up at the end of this fiscal year. So, you know, hopefully next year and bump that up some.
To be honest with you, I'd like time to digest this.
Right. It is a lot of information. If the board wants, what maybe a suggestion would be is to take this information in between now and our next meeting. If you have questions, let me know and I'll answer them at the next meeting. And then from that point, hopefully we can get a direction on where that final budget needs to go on cuts and tax rate and those type things.
Fiscal year starts July 1, right?
Yes, sir.
I got a question on the budgetary cuts here. What are any of these grant funded that you got on page one here, the capital vehicle expenditures?
They're general fund.
They're all general fund, because I know the sheriff's, I thought most of yours was from your money. Was that not right?
Well, yeah, we've been buying our vehicles, our federal drug seized monies, but I was telling our county manager that we cannot supplant the budget, any portion of budget, and by asking for seven, if seven's cut out, I can't buy any vehicles because we're supplanting the budget. Okay. Initially, it looked like we were going to be able to do it.
Okay, that's what I was going to buy. Okay. So none of these are grant funded here.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. Again, I respect what you're doing and respect the heck out of the whole situation, but I'm just maybe not sharp enough to catch some of this. And what I'd like to see us do something very simple. Start at the top. We know what our appropriations are, mm-hmm. or what we wish them to be. But on the revenue side, start at the top and come down to the from the biggest to the smallest amount of where we're losing what we would have liked to have seen. Property tax, $2 million off.
Right.
And each, beside each figure, now this is my, I'm not speaking for the board, just me. It'd be so much easier for me, though. And because I got to sell my vote to the public somehow. I've told you today that I hate to see us repair the buildings in our county off the backs of the employees. I honestly mean that. They didn't cause the courthouse to go to pot. They didn't cause the roofs to go bad. And I hate to balance the budget off of that repair deal of them.
Yes, sir.
It's not fair to them. But I've got to be willing to talk I got to be able to talk intelligently to the people I see out here in the street, if I call the radio show or if I talk to a newspaper reporter. But if you would start at the top and show me the biggest expected deficiency.
Yes, sir.
All the way down to the smallest.
Yes, sir.
In the revenue stream, and then put out beside it why.
Yes, sir.
And it'd be so much simpler for me to understand it. I don't know about y'all, but it would be for me.
Okay. More than glad to do that.
Well, the one thought about us doing the renovations, they should have been done years ago, 30 years ago.
We've discussed that in deferred maintenance.
But I'm just saying, though, it's going to be on the backs of the citizens regardless because it should have been done years and years and years ago, and it wasn't done. So now we're going to have to pay for it, and that's just the bottom line. Because it's got to be done. That's my thoughts on that one, though. Okay.
Well, I think what you recommend at the very last there to push this out a little bit further get more time to get the input.
What I was talking about, Chairman, is not, I'm not talking about not doing the repairs. I'm saying got to do the repairs. I'm talking about the debt service.
Right.
I don't want to have to find the debt service to pay for that off the backs of the Sheriff's Department or the backs of VME or anybody else. I'm sincere about
that. Yes,
sir. But
we got to figure out where it's coming.
Yeah, we got to figure out where it's coming. That's exactly right.
We got to find out where it's coming.
Well, it's got to be done.
Yeah, it's got to be done. And but if you could get that outline for me, I think I'd be a whole lot. I could sleep easier.
Okay, be more than happy to. And also, if there are specific questions that you have that you would like that information and that information presented at our next meeting, please let me know, and we will make sure that those questions are answered. You know, if there's specific information you need from a department, you know, if you're going through that pre-budget book, you got specific questions about a department, let me know, and we will make sure you will have those answers ready at our next meeting.
Okay. That'll work.
Okay.
Now you have a consensus.
We have a consensus. I do have one other thing. The ACTA meeting will be here in the Board of Commissioners room on Wednesday at 8:30 a.m. It is not a joint meeting, but you're invited to attend as we'll have representatives from the state talking about the process and some additional grant funding that ACTA may be looking at. So you are invited to attend. It's not a joint meeting, but it will be in this room at 8:30 a.m. on Wednesday.
And we would like you to be here to see what's going on with ACTA. Like, you know, that's all I want to say.
Sorry.
I don't want your money thrown away, be here.
All right.
Okay, the next thing is our consent agenda. Does anybody have anything to pull off that?
Yeah, I do.
Okay.
Wait a minute, I'm going to find it first. It's the minutes. I know they're here, but...
The minutes of the special meeting?
No, minutes of the general meeting. I don't have those in front of me, and I know they're here.
It's 10F1.
Minutes of the regular meeting, 10F. Reading through that, permitting identification process.
Where are you?
Oh, it's on the back. It's next to the last page. Certainly we all miss Mr. Teague, but he's no longer with us. And
I'm sorry, do what?
It's right here.
No, I misunderstood what you said.
Permitting identification. I think we need to change that.
Well, that's what Tim had asked for, Ann. Is that not what Tim asked for?
Yeah.
Permit identification process.
No, it's just the name wrong.
Oh, okay.
Mr. T.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Oh.
Okay.
Oops.
Okay.
Yeah, under the permitting, Mr. T. What?
Unfortunately, and we all miss him, but you know, just a, that's all right. That's the only thing I saw. Sorry.
That's all right. So that will be fine. Any other questions on the consent agenda? If not, do I hear a motion we accept the consent agenda?
So moved.
A motion in a second. All favor? With the change. Okay. Next is commissioners' comments. Does anyone have any comments tonight? Any more comments tonight?
I would like to show the headline of the newspaper I saw today. I think we have finally woken up in this country that we're in a different era. And it's not going to get any better until we take a lot of corrective action. But, you know, every paper you pick up in the state, cuts, budget, so forth and so on. School systems have to do things they thought they'd never have to do. Government's doing things that they... But this was from the... just to show you across the state line. Myrtle Beach Herald. This was April 16th, weekly edition. County considers cutting salaries, services. Subtitle, many programs will be affected during lean budget year. So forth and so on. So it's everywhere. It's simply everywhere. And it's not a pleasurable time to have to make some tough decisions. And, but I saw that on my ironing board when I came in. My son gets the mail and he laid it on the ironing board. And I saw it tonight when I left your office, went home at 6 o'clock. And I opened it up. There's the headline. I thought, it's everywhere. It's everywhere.
Craig, can I see you a minute afterwards about this dues and subscriptions?
Any announcements? If not, we are done.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.